everybody, and welcome to the session on speciation with and without sex chromosomes. And first, thank you to Suzanne for organizing this. And when Suzanne started mentioning about this conference, or this spotlight session, she had an email about with X and without X, and with sex chromosomes and without sex chromosomes. And so I said something like, this reminded me of the U2 song, With You or Without You. And that reminded me of the Joshua Tree came out 30 years ago. Also what happened 30 years ago, I started grad school, and there was talk by Jerry Coyne at a speciation meeting about the two rules of speciation. And one of these is Pauline's rule, and which is when you have one offspring, two different animal races, one sex is absent or sterile, that's the heterogeneous sex. And there's also the large X effect. And I'm going to talk briefly about the Haldane's rule, but I'm going to spend most of my time on the large X and sort of giving a historical perspective as well as future directions. So there are various aspects of Haldane's rule. There's a dominance model, which is where a hybrid of incompatibility alleles are recessive. There's a faster X effect, there's a faster male effects, and there's also faster heterogeneous sex. And all of these are explanations that are valid and apply. There's evidence for all of these. And I think we're still trying to figure out what the relative frequencies of these are. Briefly, dominance, Adam Porter and I are showing that competitive binding transcription factor binding site interactions can explain both dominance and Haldane's rule. I spoke about this last year, so I'm not going to go through any great detail about this, but we've been doing work with regulatory genetic pathways, and we show that this can lead to Haldane's rule and dominance under various circumstances. And Eric Watson is going to be talking about dominance and Haldane's rule in this session. There's also faster X involved in molecular evolution for various reasons. The X chromosome may evolve faster. This could explain Haldane's rule. I'm going to talk in a bit about how special properties of spermatogenesis can lead to Haldane's rule and large X effect. There's various rules of Haldane's rule. There's various explanations of Haldane's rule. And some of these can be applied to ZW systems, that's birds and butterflies, and some cannot. And some of these involve special relationships with the sex chromosomes, and some of them do not. So dominance can explain ZY systems, and can be involved with special role for the X chromosome. Whereas sexual selection generally cannot. The spermatogenesis is special, can explain this for the special role of X chromosomes, but it probably does not involve, or probably cannot explain ZW systems. So the large X effect, the X chromosome contributes disproportionately to the reduction of fitness observed in the hybrids between species. There are various reasons for the large X effect. One is that the X chromosome is subject to different evolutionary forces. And Joe LaChance and I had written a review 7 years ago on this. And we found that basically almost every evolutionary force, almost evolutionary pressure, can be different between the X's and the autosomes. In terms of selection, 30 years ago, the model from Brian Charles, from Jerry Quinn, and Nick Horn was the idea that an advantageous recessive more likely to be fixed on the X chromosome than on the autosomes. And there's support for this, but the more likely reason for the large X effect is sexual antagonism. That there are alleles that are going to have advantageous effect in one sex or the other, and these are going to be differentially found on the X chromosome versus the autosomes, and this could explain a large X effect. There are other reasons why we might expect a large X effect. One is that the X chromosome is more likely to be involved in mitotic drive. Another, and this is going to be, I think this is really important, is that there are various consequences of the X chromosome being homozygous. And there are various things about dosage compensations, there's various things about meiotic sex chromosome inactivation, and other types of silence. The other thing that we have to keep in mind is when we're thinking about reproductive isolation, hybrid compatibility, is that we're dealing with gene interactions. We're involving interactions between at least two genes rather than just gene interactions. This is that famous Dobzhansky mother model. So what I want to talk about is the large X effect in spermatogenesis. And quite a while ago, Lifshitz and Lindsley had made the observation that translocations between the X and the autosomes result in sterility more often than similarly sized translocations between A autosomes and other autosomes. And this is true both in mammals and in Drosophila. And they had made the mention that this is probably due to certain differences on the control of X inactivation, and this being important in terms of proper spermatogenesis. And back then, 45 years ago, they made the suggestion that this improper control of inactivation could possibly explain all the control. And this is a throwaway section in their PNAS paper. 20 years later, Chung-Yin Wu and Andrew Davis had proposed this in more detailed terms. They said that a delicate balance between certain X-linked and autosomal genes would be uniquely required for spermatogenic development. And that spermatogenesis would be the first process affected when diverging species are crossed, and that the X chromosome would be disproportionately affected. And in recent years, these predictions, this rather present argument, has been supported, mostly in mouse systems. And this is work that's been done by Jeff Good and Michael Nachman and their colleagues, crosses between different species of mouse. And the fertility of males are dependent upon both the direction of the cross and certain polygenetic genetic factors, sorry, polymorphic genetic factors. And they note that there is extensive overexpression of the X chromosome during spermatogenesis in sterile, but not in fertile F1 hybrids. And here is a account of this. And here the red represents cases of overexpression in hybrids, the blue represents cases of underexpression in hybrids, and the X chromosome is the one with a lot of red. So this is really a very clear example of the X chromosome being overexpressed, lots and lots of genes on the X chromosome being overexpressed in the F1s that are sterile, but not the ones that are fertile. And more subsequent work done by Eric Larson and others in Jeff Wade's lab showed that the X-linked genes are interacting with autosomal genes, including this famous gene PRDM9, which is a known hypersterility gene, which is also involved in regulating recombination hotspots. And there are various things that are going on between the regulation of genetic recombination and inactivation that could be explaining why there's a large X effect. And here's from their paper are some of the genes that are interacting with the apis. So I want to take a few minutes to, how much time do I have left? So various take-home messages. One is that there's pluralism. There are still these lots of explanations for both Hawking's rule and the large axiom. Another is that I think there's really good evidence for spermatogenesis in XY systems being special, that this is where a lot of that battleground is taking place, and that a lot of the explanations for Hawking's rule in XY systems are involving spermatogenesis. It also explains not just Hawking's rule, but also the large X effect. And I also want to say that there seems to be a lot more the excitement going on in mice species. That there's really good work there. This isn't just found in mice. There are also some papers that come out with domestic cats and crosses between domestic cats and some of the wildcats. And they are also finding similar effects of large X chromosome effects. And I think in terms of future directions, that's another area that needs to be done, that more crosses in mammalian systems and as well as avian systems to look at where genes are overexpressing, whether they're feeding these same patterns. And with that, I'll take questions. Yes?
I just wonder if you come back to the ZW systems, as you said, there's lots of different forces in play. Clearly, it's not spermatogenesis in the ZW system. So where does that lead you?
Well, for one thing, if you look at the ZW systems, that Hawking's rule is not more pronounced for fertility than it is for viability. Whereas in mammalian systems and in Drosophila, it is. And so I think that this comes back to that pluralism, that other explanations such as dominance, such as potentially the all,